Hi friends, welcome back to the brand new series on Angular 0 to Hero, a perfect Angular guide for beginners. In my last video, I have explained about template reference variable and @view child. In this video, I'm going to explain about lifecycle hooks in Angular. All components and directives in Angular have a lifecycle as Angular creates, updates, and destroys them. We can implement the lifecycle hook interfaces and use the respective method to tap into any lifecycle moments. Components have more lifecycle hooks than directives. These are the common lifecycle hooks available in both components and directives. And these are the lifecycle hooks available only in components. To be more specific, we can say in children components. As a side note, constructor is not a lifecycle hook. It's a TypeScript feature. I'll be explaining more about constructor, its use, and the difference between ng-on init and constructor in a separate video. Now let me explain all the component hooks using a program. I have created an application and started the server. I have also created a parent and a child component. In app component, I have added the parent component, and in parent component, I have added the child component. And so we can see this. Now let's start with ng-on-init. ng-on-init will be invoked when the component has initialized. This hook will be called only once after the first ng-on changes. We can implement the on-init interface to use this hook. Mostly we use ng-on-init for doing initializations. When we create a component using Angular CLI, we can see the ng-on-init hook has been implemented already. So let me add few console.log in both parent and child components. Now we can see the parent component constructor is called first, and then the child component constructor is called, and then the parent component ng-on-init is called, and then the child component onInit method is called. Now let me add a button in parent component and display the child component when the button is clicked. So now we can see only the parent constructor is called, and then the parent onInit is called. Child component hooks are not called because child component is not yet initialized. Now when I click the button, we can see the child constructor is called and child onInit method is also called. So we can understand once the component is loaded into the DOM, the component's constructor and the onInit method will be called. Now let's move to ng-on-destroy. OnDestroy will be called once just before the component is removed from the DOM. In other words, when the component is destroyed from the DOM. Let me introduce ng-on-destroy by implementing the OnDestroy interface in child component. When I click the button, we can see constructor is called once and then onInit is called. If I click again, onDestroy is called, and so component is removed. If I click again, component is constructed again, so constructor is called again, and then onInit is called. Clicking again will destroy it. We can understand onDestroy will be called once when the component is removed from the DOM. So if we need any cleaning activities, we can do it in onDestroy. Let me explain why we need to use onDestroy. Let me add a counter. And in onInit, let me increment that every second and printing that in the console. So once I initialize the component, we can see the counter getting incremented. But when I destroy the component, we can see the component is destroyed, but the interval we created is still running. So if I toggle the button again, we can see two intervals are running, and even after destroying, they are still running. So this is a memory leak. So we should avoid these type of memory leaks. So we can use onDestroy to clear these intervals. We can also unsubscribe if we subscribe any observables, etc. So in child component, let me get the interval and clear that in onDestroy hook. So when I click once, we can see the counter has started. And when I destroy the component, we can see the counter is also cleared. If I click again, a new counter is starting. And now it is stopped. So we have fixed the memory leak. This is the use of ng on destroy. Now let's see about ng on changes. On changes will be called once before on init and will be called whenever the data bound input properties changes. When I say data bound input, it is not the normal input in the same component. It should be something coming outside of that component through at input. Let me explain. I have created an input and used two-way binding. I am also showing the value there. Let me import forms module. And let me also comment these codes and change this flag to initialize the child component when page loads. And let me also implement onChanges interface and define ng onChanges method and put some console logs in both the components. Now we can see ng onChanges is not called before onInit. Even if I change this input value, we can see the value is getting changed, but still the ng onChanges is not called. Now let me move this input to parent component and pass this to child component through at input. Now when we load the page, we can see parent constructor is called and then parent onInit is called. After that, child constructor is called and before child onInit, we can see child onChanges is called once. When I change this input value in parent, the onChanges in child is called for every keystroke. So it is not a good practice to do any expensive operations like API call inside onChanges. Also, ng onChanges accepts a simple changes object. And using that, we can make use of previous and current values. Let me show that. So here, initially the current value is empty string, previous value is undefined, and first change is true. If I type A, we can see the current value is A now, previous value is empty string, and first change is false. Again, if I type B, we can see the current value is AB, previous value is A, and first change is false. So using this, we can do something if any particular input value changes. This is about ng on changes. Now let's look into ng docheck. Docheck will be invoked when the change detector of the given component is invoked. It is called immediately after ng on changes on every change detection run and immediately after ng on init on the first run. Let me implement docheck in both the components. Now when we load, we can see parent docheck is called just after parent onInit and child docheck is called just after child onInit. And in development mode, change detection runs twice and so we can see docheck is called one more time in each component. And when I click the button in parent, we can see the parent docheck is called. Also when I type, docheck is called again. Even when I click outside after typing, it is called again. Similarly, when I type something in parent, it triggers the onChanges in child because it is an inbound property. But we can also see the child docheck is called after child onChanges to detect changes. So we should also avoid triggering any expensive operations inside ng docheck. And also we should avoid using ng onChanges and ng docheck in the same component. I have used now just for explaining these concepts. Sometimes the change detection triggers another change and it became an infinite loop. So we should be careful about that. These are the general lifecycle hooks in both components and directives. Now let's see about component only lifecycle hooks. First, let's see ng after content init. Ng after content init will be called only once after the first docheck. To understand this hook, I need to explain about content projection. Assume I wanted to send or project some content into child from parent. I can do it like this. As it is also a tag, we can expect this to show in child component. But it won't show. We need to inform Angular where exactly we need to show the projected content. For that, we can use ng-content directive. So when I add, we can see the projected content is displaying in the child component. This is content projection, and this will be very useful when we create reusable widgets. Now let's come back to lifecycle hooks. I'm implementing after content init and then defining ng after content init method. Now in the parent content, let me add a template reference variable. We know how to access the template reference variable using @viewchild. And as this template reference variable is in content, we can access it in child component using @contentChild. Also in child component, let me add some console logs in onInit, onChanges, doCheck, and afterContentInit. If we load the page, we can see afterContentInit is called afterChild, doCheck, and also we cannot access this variable till the content is initialized. That means in all other hooks, this is coming as undefined, and only in afterContentInit, this is not undefined. Hope you understand afterContentInit hook. Let's also see afterContentChecked hook. ng-afterContentChecked will be called after ng-afterContentInit and every subsequent ng-doCheck. Let me quickly implement ng-afterContentChecked interface and use that method with a console.log. Now we can see it is called after afterContentInit. And if I type something, we can see it is called after every doCheck. Now we have ng after view init and ng after view checked. Ng after view init will be called once after the first ng after content checked. And ng after view checked will be called after ng after view init and after every subsequent ng after content checked. Let me quickly implement the interfaces, define the methods, and put some console logs. Now we can see after view init is called once after content checked. And ng after view checked is called after ng after view init and after subsequent ng after content checked. If I type something, we can see ng after content checked is called, and after that ng after view checked is also called. This is all about lifecycle hooks. And if you remember when I was explaining about template reference variable and @viewchild, I told I will explain about the second parameter in @viewchild, which was introduced as part of Angular 9. Let's see that. Let me quickly add some console.logs to see whether we are able to access child content inside all hooks. Like how we can access the parent content only after content is initialized, we can access the child content also only after the view is initialized. That means only from after view init. This is how Angular was working in older versions. But in Angular 9, a second parameter was introduced. That is static. For that, we can give true or false. Same thing applicable to content child as well. So when we add static as false, we can see there is no difference, because that is the default option. But when we change it to true, we can see we can access both parent and child content in ng on changes and ng on init itself. So this is the use of the second parameter in view child and content child. I hope you understand these concepts now. I suggest you to try these hooks once for better understanding. I have also posted this code in GitHub repo. If you want, you can take it from there. I have also provided the link in the description. Next, I am going to explain about routing in Angular. So if you haven't subscribed to this channel yet, please subscribe, press bell button, and stay tuned. Thank you. Bye.